save themselves, their own soul could heal. A shame was deeper than the sea, your grace is deeper still. Save themselves, their own soul could heal. A shame was deeper than the sea, your grace is deeper still. You alone can rescue, you alone can save, you alone can
we Let's pray. Lord God, we do desire to be overcome by your presence. What a great God you are. We have so much to be thankful for, so much to look forward to. Lord God, just thank you for this opportunity to gather together, to praise your name, to worship you. Lord, fill our hearts with your spirit now. Help us to be open to your words of truth. For they are life for each and every one of us. And they give us direction, a light for our path. Let us learn from your word this morning. Be with Dave as he brings a message. And Lord, help us to encourage each other where we need to and be the people that you've called us to be. Thank you for your generous provisions, for bringing us together, for being our God. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
I'm pretty sure there was a birthday party here, and I think it was for someone, I always get in trouble for saying this, someone much elderly, because there's a balloon here and there's a balloon up there that says over the hill. So I don't know if that pretty much sums it up, right? Okay. Now people offended, but that's okay. Turn your Bibles, please, to John chapter 7, verses 14 through 24 is what we are going to look at this morning. John chapter 7, verses 14 through 24. And the title of the message is The Audacity of Christ. The Audacity of Christ, the claims that he made were absolutely audacious. They were bold, but he made them because he was telling the truth. When you take a look at world history, it is filled with individuals who are out to make a name for themselves. You can read this all throughout history books that you may have grown up with, watching television documentaries, and so on and so forth. They did this by writing speeches. They had writings and books that became famous. They had inventions. Many of them were famous because of acts of defiance, and the list goes on and on and on. Here's some research that I found out based on a conversation that I had with someone on Easter Sunday, I believe. How many of you are familiar with Jim Jones here? Raise your hand. Remember what happened in Jonestown, South Africa, the suicide by having people drink cyanide? Folks, do you know where he was born? He was born in Crete, Indiana, which is just north of Richmond. I mean, who would have ever thought this area would be famous for something, right? All right? So, he was born in Crete, Indiana, and he eventually went there, and obviously you know what happened. So, history is filled with individuals who have been out to make a name for themselves. But even more interesting is that history is filled with individuals who wanted their followers to follow them and worship them like God. And these individuals ultimately ended up going and ruling with a terrible hand, and we know the consequences when we look at history. But when we look at the life of Jesus Christ, not only does Jesus claim to be God, but he also supplied proof of the fact that he was God by doing miracles. He was able to raise a man from the dead. He was able to have people see with their eyes. He was able to heal people, and only God could do such a thing. And we know that the ultimate miracle was when Jesus Christ rose from the dead. So Jesus, in his earthly ministry, does some crazy things that would defy science, but he's able to do it because he is God. I love this quote by Ravi Zacharias from his book, Jesus Among Other Gods, The Absolute Claims of the Christian Message. Here is what Ravi Zacharias says. He says, every other person who's at the heart of any religion has had his or her beginning either in fancy or in fact. But nevertheless, there is a beginning. Jesus' birth in Bethlehem was a moment preceded by eternity. His being neither originated in time nor came about by the will of humanity. The author of time who lived in the eternal was made incarnate in time that we might live with the eternal in view. In that sense, the message of Christ was not the introduction of a religion, but an introduction to truth about reality as God alone knows it. To deny Jesus' message while pursuing spirituality is to conjure an imaginary religion in an attempt to see heaven while sight is confined to the earth. That is precisely what Jesus challenged when he said, I have come that you may have life. His life spells living. Your life or my life apart from him spells death. This is what Jesus Christ came to do. Jesus Christ, not only did he proclaim himself to be God, but he also told the truth about who he is, and trusting in him and faith in him results in eternal life, and rejection of the truth that he offers results in eternal destruction. In John chapter 7, in the verses that we looked at last week, Jesus is in a transition period where he's going from friendliness towards him towards hostility. They've loved him so far in the first 7 chapters or so, or the first 6 chapters, but as Jesus starts to make his way towards Jerusalem, he starts to have animosity towards them, especially at the hands of the Jewish leadership. Even more amazing about this fact is this, is that Jesus' own brothers did not believe in him. Even his own brothers said to him, "Hey, look, why are you staying in this region of Galilee? Why are you talking to just a few people here? Why don't you go and make yourself known in Jerusalem? People will see you. People will see all the miracles that you have done." Here's what's interesting that we looked at last week is that Jesus, folks, he had brothers and sisters. If you were at church last week, if you were at Bible study, we looked at passages in Scripture that showed that Jesus had brothers and sisters. So what does that mean? It means that Mary did not remain a virgin for the rest of her life. The Bible tells us this, that Jesus had brothers and sisters. So it was a key doctrine that we were able to look at last week. Now this week we're going to look at Jesus heading out towards Judea, towards Jerusalem, and the leadership is present at this feast. Jesus is going to this feast. He comes in there secretly. He's not trying to draw attention to himself, but the Jewish leadership is looking for him. Where is that guy who claims to be God? Where is that guy who says he is one with the Father? Who is that guy that is trying to break apart our traditions? And this Jewish leadership is right there ready and waiting for him. This morning, I want to share with you a few things regarding the teachings of Jesus and what he had to say about himself. There's people that have all kinds of opinions about Jesus Christ. If you talk to secular people that aren't Christian, they'll say Jesus was a good man, he was a good teacher, he gave us a good model of how we're to treat other people. But in the Christian worldview, it is greater than that. Jesus made a claim that he was God. Fully God and fully man, and trust in him is the only way to obtain salvation. So this morning, we're going to look at the teachings of Jesus and what he had to say regarding himself. If you have your notes on you this morning, if you don't have your notes, just raise your hands real quick and we'll have someone get them to you real quick. If you don't have your notes, there's a couple guys, John, who might help me out. Just raise your hands real quick and he'll get them to you. First thing we're going to look at regarding the teachings of Jesus and what he had to say about himself. Number one, his teaching has heavenly origins. His teaching has heavenly origins. That's what Jesus, first of all, was trying to communicate. Look at verse 14 in John chapter 7. It says this, "Now about the middle of the feast, Jesus went up into the temple and taught." Now here's what John the Apostle is trying to communicate to us when he says, in the middle of the feast, it means that the feast was half over. Now, if you're having a really good time at a party, the last thing is you want someone to do is in the middle of the party to get up and say something awkward to mess it up, right? Like you just don't want that. If you're having a good time, everything's going well, people are celebrating, people are joyous, and then all of a sudden you get up there and you say something really dumb and it just spoils it for everyone and people remember that for the rest of their lives. But Jesus does this, the Bible says, he does this in the middle of the feast. Now why does Jesus go into the temple and do this? Remember, it was the Feast of Tabernacles. More than likely the most popular feast in Jerusalem. So Jerusalem was filled with visitors, with pilgrims, all types of people coming there. So when Jesus goes and teaches in the temple, it was more than likely very crowded because that's why all these Jewish pilgrims had come into Jerusalem. And the Bible also says this, that he goes up into the temple to teach. Now why is this? This might be kind of weird for us to look at and say, well, Jesus, you just kind of went over to this party and all of a sudden randomly you get up into the temple and you start teaching. Well, for the culture at that time, this was not uncommon because if you were a rabbi, you would go into the temple and teach. This was a common thing to do. So Jesus is there in the middle of this feast, and when he has come there, he gets up into the middle of the temple there and he begins to teach. Now, Look at verse 15. The Bible says this, and the Jews marveled. Now we're talking about the leadership here, and the Jews marveled, saying, how does this man know letters having never studied? Having never studied. You realize what's happened here? They missed out on the claims of Jesus. Why would God need to study? See, they were looking at his life. He was the son of a carpenter. He's doing ministry around the area of Galilee. There is possibly some scandal around his birth. You know about this if you read John chapter 8 and the perception that they had. So they're looking at Jesus through their eyes, through their legalistic eyes, through their religious eyes, and they're saying to themselves, how does this man know letters having never studied? And they were absolutely marveled. John says that they were marveled. Why were they marveled? Because Jesus taught with authority compared to the other Jewish teachers. For instance, take a look at Matthew chapter 7, verse 28 and 29. It says the same thing almost. It says, and so it was, when Jesus had ended these sayings, that the people were astonished at his teachings, for he taught them as one having authority and not as the scribes. Now stop and just ask yourself this question. The Bible says that Jesus gets up there and they're marveled at him, and it's as if he is one that has authority. Now, ask yourself this question. What does it mean to teach with authority? What does it mean to teach with authority? Here's what it doesn't mean. Speaking with authority doesn't mean screaming and being defiant. Let me ask you a question. How many of you ever grew up in churches where the pastor was screaming the message? Anybody here? And you're just like, man, are you feeling okay? Like, do you really love Jesus? Have you had your coffee this morning? Have you had your medication? You know, what's going on in your life? See, whenever we've grown up, you know, we've always thought in our minds, if the pastor yells it and he's spitting all over the place and he looks like he's about to have a heart attack because he hasn't taken a breath, that's what it means to preach with authority, but that's not what it means. Number two, speaking with authority acknowledges you as the mouthpiece and God as the source of power. Speaking with authority means that you are God's mouthpiece, but ultimately He is the power source. Jesus spoke with authority because He was commissioned by the Father to declare good news to those who were lost. Number three, speaking with authority means proclaiming truth over tradition. Speaking with authority means proclaiming truth over tradition. When Jesus comes and heals a man on the Sabbath, he absolutely rocks the worlds of the Jewish leadership. Since Moses' time, they come up with all these rules and traditions. And if you were to read them, you would say, it is impossible for a common man to live out these things. And so Jesus comes on the scene and he says, you know what? You've made up all of these traditions, but they have nothing to do with following God. You hear what I'm saying? You may have grown up where people had a lot of traditions, but they have nothing to do with following God. And Jesus comes on the scene and he starts to proclaim the truth, and he basically eradicates their traditions and says they're no good because they are not having you draw closer to God. And number four, speaking with authority calls people to faith and repentance, not flattery and contentment in one's spiritual condition. If there's people out there that are telling you you're okay with God and God is okay with you and everything is just fine and dandy, He's happy with you, they are lying to you. The foremost message of the gospel is that human beings are sinners and they are in need of repentance and they need to put their faith in the finished work of the cross. If someone is telling you all kinds of flattering things about yourself to boost your self-esteem, a boosted self-esteem is still going to leave you eternally separated from God. And that is what Jesus does when he speaks with authority, is that he proclaims the truth and he gets right down to the heart of the matter. In verse 15, we see a word here that is called letters. They ask this question, how does this man know letters? Now, obviously, they're not saying, well, how does Jesus know the Hebrew alphabet, okay? That's not what they're asking. They had obviously a knowledge of this because that is the culture that they grew up in. But here's what the word letters does mean. It means an exposition of the Old Testament scriptures. An exposition of the Old Testament scriptures. They were amazed by what Jesus was able to do, especially when he had no rabbinical training. How is this man able to do this? How is he able to teach with authority? How does he have these things memorized? How is he able to do such things? He spoke with authority. Not just that, but his disciples, a year later, would do exactly the same thing. Look at Acts chapter 4, verse 13. It says, "Now when they saw the boldness of Peter and John and perceived that they were uneducated and untrained men, they marveled and they realized they had been with Jesus." Absolutely amazing. Here's what is happening here. They say, how does this man know letters having never studied? Here's the point here. Since they were not able to attack the credibility of Jesus in regards to sound doctrine, they attacked his background. The commentary note says this: if they could have condemned Jesus on some false doctrine or wrong understanding of scripture, they would have. Since they could not be attacked, they attacked the credentials of Jesus. These words are spoken in the true bigotry and prejudice of so-called learning. There was nothing about Jesus that they could condemn. His life, his ministry, everything that he was doing was pure and holy and in obedience to the Father. But they did not like Jesus. So what did they do? They attacked his background. They were condescending towards him. He's not like us. He does not have the certificate. He does not have the degrees. Look at who we are. Look at this guy. Do you really want to follow him? Folks, what would we do in American culture if we had Jesus standing in front of us and all the Pharisees before us and we were looking for a pastor of a church? We would more than likely select the Pharisee because he's got the best training. Let's be honest, it exposes our hearts. Let me share with you a few application points regarding this attack against Jesus and how this fits for your life, because I think this is absolutely important. If you're following in your notes, I have a point here that says this: training in ministry is a good thing, but it must be second to a heart that is obedient in following God's will. Training in ministry is a good thing, but it must be second to a heart that is obedient in following God's will. Let me share with you, just for a few moments, some profound aspects about being used of God and by God. Some things that I think will be very helpful to you. Number one is this. You can write this down because I don't have it in the notes because there are too many. First thing is this, is that training in Bible college and seminary is a good thing, but it doesn't replace a daily walk with God. Nah. Folks, can I share with you? You can have a lot of Bible knowledge. You can know it all. You can know all the books. You can know the doctrines. You can know if somebody says to you, "Hey, where's that verse located?" And you know it just right away. But facts about the Bible does not replace your daily walk with God. If you know the facts of the Bible but are living in sin and disobedience towards God, God doesn't care. He is not pleased. Number two is this. No one is ever qualified to do ministry. You hear that? No one is ever qualified to do ministry. God qualifies the unqualified. Remember that. No one is qualified to do ministry. God qualifies the unqualified. Share with you a quick story about myself. You would be shocked, but if you knew me in junior high and high school, at least until 10th or 11th grade, I was an extremely shy kid. I did not want to get up in front of people and talk. Nothing infuriated me or made me scared than doing that. But you know what? God's got a sense of humor. Some reason, he found it necessary to equip me to do this, and now I just can't shut my mouth. If you know me, right? I just keep on talking. But here's what's amazing is that God is the one that ends up qualifying us, not us. We can have all the degrees in the world. We can be super smart and people can be impressed by us. But if we want to be used by God for His glory, I need to get rid of my own glory. That is what Jesus is trying to teach us. Here's another thing, is that God has changed the world through His gospel by using people the world deemed useless. God has proclaimed His gospel by using people the rest of the world looked down on. Jesus used fishermen and tax collectors and sinners. Society looked down at them and said, who in the world would use them? But Jesus said, I'm going to qualify you for the work of the ministry. Do you realize that you and I are saved today? For those who have trusted in Christ, we have a Bible before us because 12 disciples who are not qualified, Jesus qualified them, and they went to the utmost parts of the earth. My family is saved because of Thomas coming to India and the influence of Christianity in India. It is by God using people that are not qualified. Do you realize that in parts of the world, there are people of the most lowest stature? For instance, in India, they have a caste system. And if you know anything about the caste system, the lowest group of people are called the untouchables. They're more than likely the ones to be enslaved, to be abused. People look down on them, they abuse them. It is some of the most horrific things that happen. But you know what happens when the gospel goes into their hearts and God changes them? Guess what they're doing? They're reaching the masses of the untouchables with the gospel of Jesus Christ. We would say, no, 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 you know what you need to do? Why don't we just wait and get somebody trained in seminary, and then why don't we just stick them over there, and we'll have a nice little program for them, and that's what God will use. And God says, that's not what I want. I want a heart that is willing to serve me, to walk with me daily. I'm going to qualify them. Here's something else, is that every Christian is a minister. You're saying, what? I thought the guy that's standing up there on a Sunday morning is the minister. No. If you are a child of God this morning, you are a co-laborer with Christ, in Christ, to those in the body of Christ. Every single person is a minister in the body of Christ if you are a Christian. Not just that, ministry is about making Jesus known, not ourselves. Ministry is about making Jesus known, not ourselves. So whatever capacity God has given you, are you using it? Are you doing it faithfully? Paul Tripp has a great quote. He says this, personal ministry is not about always knowing what to say. It is not about fixing everything in sight that is broken. Personal ministry is about connecting people with Christ so that they are able to think as He would have them think, desire what He says is best, and do what He calls them to do, even if their circumstances never get fixed. It involves exposing hurt, lost and confused people to God's glory so that they give up their pursuit of their own glory and live for His. That's what it means to do ministry and to be qualified by God. Verse 16 says this, Jesus answered and said to them, my doctrine is not mine, but His who sent me. This was a statement juxtaposing the authority of God against the authority of man. These rabbis, these teachers were teaching their own doctrines, but Jesus is saying, this doctrine is not mine, but the one who sent me. The Father is always true. John chapter 8, 28 and 29, then Jesus said to them, when you lift up the Son of Man, then you will know that I am He, and that I do nothing of myself, but as my Father taught me, I speak these things. And He who sent me is with me. The Father has not left me alone, for I always do these things that please Him. John 12, 49 and 50, for I have not spoken on my own authority, but the Father who sent me gave me a command, what I should say and what I should speak. And I know that His command is everlasting life. Therefore, whatever I speak, just as the Father has told me, so I speak. You know what Jesus is saying in making these statements? In making these statements, Jesus was making the words He was speaking equal with those God would speak. Can you imagine how astounding this must have been to the Jewish leadership? Jesus is saying to them, whatever God the Father is saying, that is what I am communicating to you. You think they just took that lightly? Here's this guy from Galilee doing ministry. He's a carpenter's son. And he's claiming that the words that he speaks are from the Father, but that's exactly what Jesus said. But not just that, the rabbis would receive their teaching from other rabbis as their source of authority. That's why they were upset. Rabbis would teach other rabbis who would teach other rabbis who would teach other rabbis. Their authority was human beings. Jesus is saying, the Father is the one that is speaking through me. Let me share with you a few things that I think are interesting about this, and I think it hits on our culture today. I've always had an issue when I'm watching television especially, and how many of you have ever heard this, when guys on Christian television get up and say, the Lord has given me a word. Anybody heard that? The Lord has given me a word. Okay? Now, let me preface it by saying this. God can speak to you through His Word and life experiences. I don't deny that. You know, sometimes you're going through something in your life, and all of a sudden you read the daily bread, and you're like, wait a minute, time out. That was a little creepy, okay? How do you know God, this was happening? Okay, you're God. All right, that's fine. God can speak to us through His Word and life experiences. But let me share this with you. When someone says that they have a new revelation from God, you know what they're saying? Think about this, logically. If someone says to you that they have a new revelation from God, they're essentially saying, the Bible is not complete. God has given us His finished Word. So when some guy gets up there on television and starts to say, the Lord has given me a new revelation, what they're saying is that the Bible is not enough. God has some more stuff yet to do. That's why we have all kinds of cults all over the place. We need to be very aware of what is happening in our world. We need to be discerning as Christians as to what we read, what we listen to. Jesus is saying, my doctrine is not my own, but it is the one who has sent me. So number one, Jesus shows us that His teachings have a heavenly origin. Let's look at number two. His teaching showed God's desire to respond to those who are seeking Him. His teachings showed God's desire to respond to those who are seeking Him. Look at verse 17. If anyone wills to do His will, he shall know concerning the doctrine whether it is from God or whether I speak on my own authority. Here's what's amazing about this, is that multiple times throughout Jesus' ministry, they always asked Him to perform additional signs and miracles to authenticate who He was, but He always refused. They would just not believe in Him. It was never good enough. And Jesus condemned them for it. For instance, look at Matthew 16, verses 1 through 4. Then the Pharisees and Sadducees came and testing Him, asked that He would show them a sign from heaven. He answered and said to them, when it is evening, you say, it will be fair weather, for the sky is red. And in the morning, it will be foul weather today, for the sky is red and threatening. Hypocrites, you know how to discern the face of the sky, but you cannot discern the signs of the times. A wicked and adulterous generation seeks after a sign, and no sign shall be given to it except the sign of the prophet Jonah. He left them and departed, referring to His death, burial, and resurrection. They always wanted something more. They just refused to submit themselves to God. So what does this teach us? What is Jesus trying to imply when He says this? Here it is, number one. The issue is never a lack of evidence. It is a hardened heart that refuses to submit to God. That's the issue right there. It's not a lack of evidence. It is a hardened heart that refuses to submit to God. There are people who refuse to believe in God, and you may have run into them. Can I share with you that God has given us more than enough evidence regarding His creation, His attributes, to prove to us that He exists? Read Romans chapter 1 sometime. When I look at creation, there is no way that I can conclude that this just came about by random process. There's just way too much order there for it to be random. There had to be a creator. Why do people reject? Even though there's all this evidence, you know why they reject? Here it is. The problem becomes, the moment I acknowledge that God exists, guess what? I acknowledge that I must give an account of the way that I live. Folks, you got to understand this. If God does not exist, I want you to think about this logically. And if you run into people, you need to ask them this question. If God does not exist, who decides morality? Who gets to decide what is right and wrong? If there is no God, you can abort children and not even flinch, because after all, there is no God, and that child that has been aborted has same type of value as any type of animal that is out there in the jungle. But if God does exist and He's the creator of all human beings, and human beings are the height of God's creation, then that child in the womb has just as much value as you and I that are sitting here today. That is the issue that we need to think about and look at. When you look at our world today, when you're looking at politics, you have a lot of people that are talking about this issue of abortion, and they just kind of brush it off on the side. You know, it's amazing, whatever your political leanings, Hillary Clinton was on The View, right? That's where you want to get your theological training from, okay? So she's on The View, and they asked her a question about abortion, and here's the statement that she said. She said, even at the third trimester, right before the child is to be born, she said this, the unborn, listen to this word, the unborn person, she said person, has no constitutional rights. Folks, think about what is happening. That is not some political problem. That is a worldview problem. And then she had the audacity 2 minutes later to say, I call myself a Christian. Can I tell you, you cannot call yourself a Christian and hold to that worldview. I don't care how popular that is. If it contradicts the Word of God, it is not Christian. You don't get to formulate your own opinion regarding what God says. It is the kind of world that we are living in today. Number two, those who are seeking after Him, He will respond through the work of the Holy Spirit. Deuteronomy 4:29. But from there you will seek the Lord your God, and you will find Him if you seek Him with all your heart and with all your soul. 1 Corinthians 2:10-14. But God has revealed them to us through His Spirit. For the Spirit teaches us all things, yes, the deep things of God. For what man knows the things of a man except the spirit of man which is in him? Even so, no one knows the things of God except the Spirit of God. Now we have received not the spirit of the world, but the Spirit who is from God, that we might know the things that have been freely given to us by God. These things we also speak, not in words which man's wisdom teaches, but which the Holy Spirit teaches, comparing spiritual things with spiritual things. But the natural man does not receive the things of the Spirit of God, for they are foolishness to him, nor can he know them because they are spiritually discerned. You know what he's trying to say? He said, when you look at lost humanity around the world today, the issue is not simply a good and bad problem. The issue is their eyes have not been opened to the truth through the work of the Holy Spirit. They have not responded. Folks, we're always going around talking about changing laws, right? If we just change the laws, everything will be okay. If there's laws, there's always going to still be sinners, right? There's still going to be sinners. Look at all kinds of laws that we have, and we should have good laws. But sin will always exist because it exists within human beings. If we want someone to turn from their wicked ways, it's not by saying, guess what, I'm going to change you by having 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 laws, and that's going to do it for you. They're still going to be a sinner. But if we want people to see biblically what must happen in their life, they must be aware of the gospel of Jesus Christ and be changed through the work of the Spirit in their life. That's how someone changes their worldview. And that is what Jesus is asking us to do. Those who do trust in Christ will be freed from the bondage of sin. John 8:32. And you shall know the truth, and the truth shall make you what? Truth shall make you free. Think about how freeing it is to be a Christian today. That your dependence on getting into heaven isn't based on a bunch of rules that you have to try to live up to and check off, right? Can you imagine the rest of the world that tries to live that way? If you think about Islam, you think about Hinduism, Buddhism, all these rules and regulations, things that you have to eat, first of all, ain't no way I'm following a religion if I'm not allowed to eat pork and bacon, okay? There's just no way that's happening, all right? What kind of religion is that? So anyways, so if you think about it, all these rules and regulations and live up to them. There's no way. But I'm so thankful that there was someone, the perfect Son of God, who obeyed the law perfectly and took my sin on Him. And the only thing I must do is respond in faith. And He forgives me forever. You see how easy that is? You have the law, you have works, you have all kinds of rules and regulations, and here you have faith. But human beings, what do they want to do? No, that's just too easy. Let me go back to the law. If you want to be free, Jesus says the truth will make you free. Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. Number three, His teaching showed His obedience to the Father. Look at verse 18. He who speaks from himself seeks his own glory, but he who seeks the glory of the one who sent him is true, and no unrighteousness is in him. Let me share with you two signs of false teachers. There's many, and you can catch them, but there's two big signs if you want to catch a false teacher. Number one is that they are the only authority. They are the only authority. If someone dare question them, they are kicked out. They're the only authority. Number two, they seek their own fame and gain. They seek their own fame and gain. For instance, if you ever study cults, these two things are very evident in the life of that person that is leading these movements. They were filled with power and corruption. They lived immoral lifestyles while claiming that God spoke to them. They had massive crowds following them. But just let's take it one step further here. And then let me share this with you regarding what Jesus was saying here. If there is any teacher that bypasses the need for the cross and claims your happiness is the ultimate goal in life, that person is a false teacher. Hello. If someone bypasses the cross of Jesus Christ and says God wants you to be happy and that is the ultimate aim in life, that's a false teacher. Stop listening to them. Another thing is this. If there is any faith that refuses to accept Jesus as the only way to heaven, guess what? It is a false faith. If there is any faith that refuses to say faith alone in Jesus is the only way to heaven, it is a false faith. If there is any faith that says that the Bible alone isn't the true Word of God, the 66 books of the Bible, guess what? It is a false faith. Folks, if Jesus truly did say that He is the way, the truth, and the life, and we have His Word, we as Christians are not going to falter from that. It is what God has called us to do. We are not seeking our own glory because our own glory is fading. But Jesus is saying we need to seek His glory, seek the Father's glory, and to make Him known. It's amazing to me how, even in our culture today, people always lift up, you know, actors and actresses and athletes, right? And we really praise them and we glorify them. But the moment they do one small, minute thing, guess what? People just turn against them. We see this all around us. What does that teach me? Is that glory for us is fleeting very fast. It's there for a moment, but then it's gone. It's just vanity at the end of the day. But Jesus' glory is what we should seek to make known. Jesus always sought to glorify the Father in His ministry. Matthew 28:28. Just as the Son of Man did not come to be served, but to serve and to give His life as a ransom for many. In John 13, when He's with His disciples, the Bible says He rose from supper and laid aside His garments, took a towel and girded Himself. After that, He poured water into a basin and began to wash the disciples' feet and to wipe them with the towel with which He was girded. Only a slave would do that in that culture. But Jesus did it for His disciples. The Jewish leaders despised Jesus because He actually aimed to please God, and that was something they detested. They were after their own glory. Lastly, and I close with this, His teaching condemned those who rejected Him. Verses 19-24, His teaching condemned those who rejected Him. Look at verse 19. It says, did not Moses give you the law? Yet none of you keeps the law. Why do you seek to kill me? The people answered and said, you have a demon who is seeking to kill you. Aren't they lying to him at this point? That's exactly what they wanted to do. They wanted to kill him. The Jews had the law, but yet they were disobedient towards God. Romans 2, 17 to 20 says this, indeed you are called a Jew and rest on the law, and make your boast in God and know his will and approve the things that are excellent, being instructed out of the law, and are confident that you yourself are a guide to the blind, a light to those who are in darkness, an instructor of the foolish, a teacher of babes, having the form of knowledge and truth in the law. They were given the law to instruct people with. But what's amazing is that Jesus called out the problem with the Israelites, and it was the same problem that God had with their leadership in the Old Testament. Look at what God says about them. Isaiah 29, there's multiple passages where he says this. Inasmuch as these people draw near with their mouths and honor me with their lips, but have removed their hearts far away from me, and their fear toward me is taught by the commandment of men. Can you identify with people like this? They come and pretend that they are near to God. They sing about God. They're reading things about God, but their hearts are far removed from him. Jesus was condemning the Jewish leadership because from a human perspective, they would be the ones that would be the closest to God because they were involved in the teaching of the law, they were involved in the Levitical practices and making sure that people had a reconciler between them and God. Everything was on the outside and God is saying, but their heart is far removed from me. God doesn't care about lip service. He really doesn't. Is your heart right towards him? Jesus says, you're trying to kill me. It exposes your heart. You're trying to kill the Son of God. The last verse is verse 21 to 24. Jesus answered and said to them, I did one work and you all marvel. Moses therefore gave you circumcision, not that it is from Moses, but from the fathers. And you circumcise a man on the Sabbath. If a man receives circumcision on the Sabbath, so that the law of Moses should not be broken, are you angry with me because I made a man completely well on the Sabbath? Do not judge according to appearance, but judge with righteous judgment. Something that Jesus says is that circumcision, it predated the law. For instance, in Genesis 17, 12, he who is 8 days old among you shall be circumcised, every male child in your generations. He who is born in your house or bought with money from a foreigner who is not your descendant. Here's what Jesus is doing. He is pointing out their fallacy. And here's how it is. If it was okay for the Jews to circumcise on the Sabbath day, why was it wrong for Jesus to make a man whole on the Sabbath? If it was a good thing according to the law to circumcise in the Old Testament, and that was a good thing, why was it a bad thing to make someone physically and spiritually whole on the Sabbath? Not just that, but here was God who was performing this on the Sabbath. The Sabbath was not made for God, it was made for man. Jesus, being fully God, was not breaking the Sabbath. He points out their contradiction. Matthew 12. Then he said to them, what man is there among you who has one sheep, and if it falls into a pit on the Sabbath, will not lay hold of it and lift it out? Of how much more value then is a man than a sheep? Therefore, it is lawful to do good on the Sabbath. Bam! See how Jesus does that? I think that's amazing. You know, we would be sitting there going, well, let me articulate this great argument, and let me try to use some big words. And Jesus says, let me just illustrate it for you. If a sheep falls into a ditch, and it's the Sabbath day, are you going to let it suffer, or are you going to go get it out?
We're going to get it out.
Okay, you did a good work. Jesus, using simple illustrations regarding the kingdom of God. Lastly, here's what it was, is that Jesus was encouraging the Jewish leadership to truly look into the law, because if they did, they would be able to see the true claims of Jesus. Here's what it boils down to. They had the law, they had the word of God, but they were interested in their own traditions, and their traditions would leave them eternally separated from God. Now, when you're sitting in this room today, and I close with this point, what are you really trusting in regarding your eternity? Is it all the traditions that you've learned and what your grandparents and parents did, and this was the thing that we did, so therefore we're going to do the same thing? You realize in our communities there's all kinds of people going to church for that reason? Well, I'm going because my parents went and my grandparents went, so naturally I think I need to do the same thing. God is saying, who cares? You're doing all the religious stuff, but your heart is far removed from me. You live like the devil Monday through Saturday, and then you pretend on Sunday and you do the same thing the rest of the week. That's a false faith. Has God not changed your heart? God is more interested in a transformed heart that is walking with Him every single day. That is caring about pleasing Him and seeking His glory rather than our glory. It was the problem that Jesus had when He was making these claims, and it's unfortunate He had to make these claims because the most religious people that had the Word of God were far removed from Him. What is God trying to communicate to you through His Word? Is your heart there? Is your heart trusting in Him? Does your heart truly believe in Him? Or are you still operating by a checklist? Come to the cross. Be freed from the bondage of good works. Because there's no amount of good works you can do to please God, because His Son, Jesus Christ, did the ultimate work by taking our place on the cross and rising victoriously from the dead. Have you put your faith in Christ and been freed from the bondage of works and the sin in your life? Let's bow for a word of prayer. Father in heaven, I pray, Lord, as we come to this short time of invitation where we get to reflect on our life and how we are and how we stand before You, Father, I pray that You would convict hearts in this room. Lord, there's a lot of us that think that our good works and our religion is going to be good enough on Judgment Day, but You have offered us what that day is going to look like. And the only thing that You're going to wait for that day is to see if we have the true righteousness of Jesus Christ. If we have been forgiven, if we are covered in the blood of Christ, that is the only requirement that is needed to enter into eternal life with You. Father, I pray just in these few moments, if there is someone that does not know You as their Savior, Father, I pray that You would convict their heart right now. And Lord, I pray that they would just turn to You and say, yes, I believe. I believe I'm a sinner. I believe I need eternal life. And I believe what Jesus Christ did for me by His finished work on the cross. Lord, I pray that You would convict hearts at this time. Father, even as Christians, sometimes we get so caught up in this, I got to do these things for the rest of the day and then I'm going to be made right with God. Give us assurance that we are already right with God because we have put our faith in Your Son, Jesus Christ. But Lord, convict us when we are not following You and teach us to be obedient, just like Your Son was obedient. Just in these few moments, Father, I pray that You would speak to hearts at this time. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Keep your heads bowed, eyes closed. Just these few moments. Where are you at in your walk with God? Have you never trusted Him as your Savior? Well, why are you waiting for? Eternity hangs in the balance. Put your faith in it. I believe. I believe I'm a sinner. I believe what happened on the cross was true. I believe Jesus rose from the dead. I want to become a Christian. Between you and God, and God will save you. What about as a Christian? Do you need encouragement to walk with God? Don't get hung up on rules and regulations. Focus on your walk. Ask God how He would convict you this week so that you can make changes in your life to follow Him closely. Before we leave, Derek, do you have anything that you want to share, okay? Remember our Bible study this week? Tuesday and Wednesday, we've been having some really good discussions. So in Brookville, we meet at the Works of Mercy Center at 7 o'clock. Great discussions, and Tuesday night at my home. If you have not been plugged into a Bible study, really encourage you to do so. Just Sunday morning is not good enough sometimes. You need a midweek boost, encouragement. If you're able to make it out, please do your best to come out to that. May the 8th is Mother's Day. So there's a new baby that has arrived, and I think there's a few of them. We're going to do a baby dedication on May the 8th. Want to be aware of that. Also, big stuff happening this week, this Friday. Anybody want to guess what this Friday is? It's not the Passover. Okay, that's already Passover. Friday, we're signing on the building. We're going to make it official, okay? So that's pretty exciting, yeah. So be in prayer for that process. Inspections went well, everything went well, and we're ready to finalize it. Thank God for that and His blessing on that, and then even moving forward. So here's what changes as we move into the building. It's just that we meet in a different building. The church doesn't change. It's still the body of Christ, regardless of where we meet. So we need to understand that, but it's an exciting time. So pray that everything goes well and everything works out, and as we transition into that. So be in prayer for that situation, and we praise God for that. Let's stand as we dismiss with a word of prayer. Don, if you want to come out here and close us out. Don is regretting being here this week because he was in Arizona for the last 2 weeks visiting his family. It's just like Arizona weather here, right? I guess the laugh says it all.
Father, we're thankful that we can gather around your word, and Lord, that you've taught us, and Lord, that you've given us the Holy Spirit, Lord, that we might be close to you, you might teach us through your Spirit and reveal yourselves to us. And Lord, we just thank you for your word. And Lord, we just thank you for what you're doing with the church, and you provided a building. And Lord, may this church grow and put out your word and minister to those that need you, Lord. Change our hearts, Lord. Help us become more like you and follow you with true hearts. And Lord, we thank you for everything you've done and everything you're going to do. And we ask it in Christ's name. Amen.